Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Anna, aka NeuroGal MD. I'm a neurologist who loves making videos about the brain and neuroscience. And over the past year, I've really enjoyed making music reaction videos because number one, I love music. And number two, music is very good for the brain. It can help us heal. It can help us access emotions more easily, process those emotions more easily. Creating music, playing music is incredibly good for the brain and has anti-aging effects on the brain. So I can go on and on about the benefits of music in our lives. Today I'll be watching Happy by NF with you guys. Let's get started.
Dear God, please hear me out, I know it's been a couple years since I've reached out and said hello. I bet you're wondering why I keep obsessing on and stressing all the little things when I should be living life and soaking up the memories. I know I've been selfish, I have no excuse to give you, it's true. Hanging by a thread's how I live. I don't know why, but I feel more comfortable living in my agony, watching my self-esteem go up in flames, acting like I don't care what anyone else thinks, when I know truthfully that that's the furthest thing from how I feel. But I'm too proud to open up and ask you to pick me up and pull me out this hole I'm trapped in. The truth is I need help, but I just can't imagine I was happy, yeah. Been this way so long, it feels like something's off when I'm not depressed. I got some issues that I won't address. I got some baggage I ain't open yet. I got some demons I should put to rest. I got some traumas that I can't forget. I got some phone calls I've been avoiding. Some family members I don't really connect with. Some things I said I wish I would've not let slip. Some hurtful words that never should've left my lips. Some bridges burn, I'm not ready to rebuild yet. Some insecurities I haven't dealt with yet. I'll be the first to admit that I'm a lonely soul, and the last to admit I need a hand to hold. Losing hope, headed down a dangerous road. Strange, I know, but I feel most at home when I'm living in my agony, watching my self-esteem go up in flames, acting like I don't care what anyone else thinks, when I know truthfully that that's the furthest thing from how I feel. But I'm
okay. Well, wow. I need a tissue. Put that right there. So the video follows the life of this woman who, as a young girl, her life is in disarray. Her mom seems like she's dealing with depression, so the girl is left fending for herself often. She sees turmoil between her mom and her dad, fighting all the time, it seems. There's a lot of tension in the house. And then the house is in disarray. It's just symbolic of her life. The video flashes forward to this woman's life as an adult. She's repeating her past, right? She's fighting with her partner. Her house is in disarray. She's not taking care of herself. She feels isolated, it seems like. This highlights how easy it is to repeat what you see in childhood when you move on to adulthood. It's so easy to do that, because your neural networks are primarily formed when you are a child. What you see, what you experience, that forms how you tend to view reality for the rest of your life. I'm actually just starting a book by a man named Bruce Lipton. He's a scientist who has some hypotheses about how someone's thoughts can directly influence the expression of genes. This is called epigenetics, and thereby influence their probability of developing illnesses such as cancer and other lifestyle-related diseases. Basically, the way he breaks down the psyche is into two separate categories, the subconscious and then the conscious. A lot of psychologists psychiatrists, neuroscientists have already done this. Bruce Lipton describes it pretty well. I like the way he describes it. Your subconscious is your kind of foundational programming. And your subconscious programming is largely developed by the time you're 7 years old. So if you see a lot of turmoil, a lot of fighting within close family members, depression, all of these things, then that is how your neural networks form, to view life through that lens, and it becomes your subconscious programming. That is why you tend to repeat those patterns as an adult. If you are told that you are not lovable, that you shouldn't be happy, or if it's demonstrated to you that you are not lovable, if you're neglected as a child, then you believe it because your subconscious programming is programmed within those formative years. So then throughout life, even though you may consciously want to be happy, you may want to feel loved, subconsciously you don't feel like you deserve it. You don't feel like you deserve happiness or love or good things. And it seems like that's what's going on with this woman. So this brings to mind the question of free will. Are we just predestined to repeat our past, repeat our generational trauma? Is it a hopeless case? Are we just doomed to a life of unhappiness and self-sabotage? I have my own opinion, but let's see what NF thinks. I know truthfully that that's the furthest thing from how I feel, but I'm too proud to open up and ask you to pick me up and pull me out this hole I'm trapped in. The truth is I need help, but I just can't imagine who I'd be if I was happy. Don't know what's around the bend. Don't know what my future is. Just looking in the mirror. But I can't keep on living in. Living in my agony, watching my self-esteem go up in flames, acting like I don't care what anyone else thinks, when I know truthfully that that's the furthest thing from how I feel, but I'm too proud to open up and ask you to pick me up and pull me out this hole I'm trapped in. The truth is I need help, but I just can't imagine who I'd be if I was happy. I was happy. Wow. Ooh, I need to gather myself before I say anything. This woman, the first part of the video, we see her miserable, basically repeating her traumatic past from childhood. And then there's a turn in the second part of the video where she looks at herself in the mirror. And that to me is so symbolic for looking at yourself and taking, owning your life. Regardless of what you've experienced in the past, acknowledging that you can change. And that is our answer to the question of free will. Are we predestined to repeat our past, to repeat our generational traumas? I truly believe that as human beings, we can change it. We have free will. And what makes us capable of changing that subconscious programming that I talked about is something called the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is within the frontal lobe. The frontal lobe of the human brain is much more advanced compared to other animal species, and that is what allows us to have self-awareness and higher level thinking. So that allows us to override our subconscious programming. Our subconscious programming is mainly formed within a part of the brain called the limbic system. This is this emotional primitive part of our brain that allows us to have emotions. But that the frontal lobe and the prefrontal cortex allows us to not only override the limbic system or our subconscious programming, but it also allows us to be more conscious of them, recognize where they come from, and work to change them. So the frontal lobe, the higher level thinking that humans are capable of, gives us free will. And every single one of us is capable of overriding our subconscious programming. Number one, we have to look at ourselves in the mirror and acknowledge what it is that is making us self-sabotage, that is keeping us from true happiness and joy. And that is the subconscious programming that was built within our brains from an early age. So that's the first step. And then the rest is constantly working to change the programming, that subconscious programming, whether it's through counseling, journaling, or listening to music, or partaking in physical activities that help ground a hyperactive, fearful subconscious programming. We could do this by doing physical activities like yoga, dancing, exercising. I thought it was really interesting that the last part of the video involves her driving to her mom's house. She's reaching out to the people she loves and acknowledging that she can't heal from the trauma alone, that she needs others in her life to move past those traumas. This makes me think of the concept of co-regulation. So regulation is when we are able to have a balanced emotional state. There are two major forms of regulation, self-regulation and co-regulation. Self-regulation involves being able to self-soothe during times of stress. Co-regulation, on the other hand, involves someone else helping to soothe us when we are so emotionally dysregulated that we just cannot self-soothe. The ability to self-soothe stems from our childhood, and it largely results from our parents repeatedly co-regulating with us when we're unable to control our emotions, so when we have tantrums as children. And then over time, they teach us through their co-regulation how we can regulate our own emotions independently. Self-regulation is a very important aspect of being an adult, and it's important for us to self-soothe and calm ourselves, especially if we don't have anyone around us. But I do think that co-regulation, which is having someone else to help calm you down when you are just so far away from the ability to self-regulate, is also really important. And I think it's one of the main reasons why society is so sick these days, because we are all, especially in Western worlds, we are all so detached and isolated from each other. We're never really meaningfully connecting with one another on a level that allows for co-regulation. And I think quite a bit has to do with the recent pandemic. It's been really stressful for everyone, and I think it just put everyone into an even more isolated state. And so we're trying to come out of that state, but people are struggling. We had these struggles before the pandemic, but the pandemic exacerbated them. So going back to this story of this woman, she is reaching out to her mom because she loves her and she needs someone to help her co-regulate. She recognizes that she needs other people to help her through the trauma. So whether that's for you reaching out to family members or friends or a counselor, someone to help you co-regulate during the times when you can't self-regulate is really important. This was a powerful song. It just hits home. I wanted to leave you guys with one last note. This was actually a comment written by one of my subscribers, George Kelly. Shout out to George Kelly, because this comment was so wise and I wanted to share it with you, and I do think it ties in to this song. If you are aimed at what is right, what is good, God will put before you obstacles to maximize your evolution. And if you take those obstacles with gratitude, he will give you the strength to endure any darkness. On the other side of fear is freedom. God puts obstacles in your life and people in your life for a reason, to allow you to evolve into a higher spiritual level. If you're courageous enough to confront the fear involved in confronting these obstacles, then on the other side of that is freedom and self-awareness, peace and joy and love. He also said, practicing gratitude for my challenges and the lessons they offered daily pulled me out of my depression and allowed me to ditch my medication. I've never been happier. Practicing gratitude. So hard to do. Maybe we could do the 30-day practicing gratitude challenge. Every day, write down three things that you're grateful for, first thing in the morning, and see if that changes your outlook on life. It's hard to do. I mean, honestly, you guys need to hold me accountable. I'm going to start. This is my day one of doing it regularly for 30 days. And I want you guys to do it with me. And then at the end, maybe I'll make like a little short video saying how I've done. And then if you guys want to comment on how you've done in the comments, I would love to know how it works for you. Practicing gratitude takes me back to the video because this girl, this woman, at the end of the video, she is remembering all the good times that she had. She wasn't completely miserable during her birthday party. There were happy moments, right? She had happy, loving moments with her mom. And it seemed to me like she was practicing gratitude. So on that note, I am going to end this video. Love to all of you, and we'll catch you next time.